Okay, so with this lecture we begin our study of Laguerre polynomials. So this is the third kind of polynomials. Sort of we had these general classes, and so this is going to correspond to the next sequence of polynomials, which also fits into this broad umbrella which we came up with. Okay, so the Laguerre polynomials are obtained when we take s of x is equal to x, w of x is equal to e to the minus x. So this weight function has an important role here, and the limits now a and b correspond to 0 and infinity. So we have seen that if a is finite and b is plus infinity, then you can just choose a to be 0, right? So that's what this case corresponds to, and here the weight function has an important role, so it is taken to be e to the minus x. So if you do this, the Rodrigues formula that comes up when you plug in these expressions is the following. So ln of x is given by e to the x divided by n factorial, where we are choosing this normalization constant in a suitable way, as we will discuss as we go along. And so you have e to the x divided by n factorial times the nth derivative of e to the minus x times x to the n equal to 0, 1, 2, so on. So you can check that this formula reproduces for you a bunch of polynomials, right? So you notice that whenever you take a derivative of this product, you're eventually always going to end up with some e to the minus x in every term, and that will cancels with this, and you're going to have a polynomial in x, right? So let's explicitly write down the first few. So we see that L naught of x is just 1, because L naught is like not taking any derivative, e to the x goes with e to the minus x, and then you're just left with x to the 0 divided by 0 factor, which is the same as 1. And then L1 of x, you can quickly see, is just minus x plus 1. L2 of x is half times x squared minus 4x plus 2, and L3 of x is 1 by 6 times minus x cubed plus 9x squared minus 18x plus 6. So all of these are directly obtainable using the Rodrigues formula, right? So for the smallest few, it's convenient to just do direct differentiation. It's only when you need higher order polynomials that you may want to come up with some other way of obtaining those polynomials. Okay, so one observation we make, okay, let us plot these functions, and then I will tell you what this observation, which we can also make from the plot. Okay, the first function is just a constant, nothing much happening there. The second one is going to be linear, and it's going down as a function of x. And the third one is a quadratic function, but it's it goes down and then goes back up, right? It is negative in some region, but then again it becomes positive. And then we see that the next member of the sequence, starts going down, then goes back up, and then turns around again, and then keeps going down after that. So there are regions where it's negative, then there's a region where it's positive, and then there's again a region where it becomes negative and large, right? So clearly these polynomials are, they don't have to become nice and small for large x. They can become quite large, positive or negative. It's the burden of convergence for these inner products and so on will be entirely on this weight function w of x, which is exponentially decaying, so there's no problem. It's definitely going to be able to take care of it. So the observation that is useful to make here is that all of these functions start at the same point. At x equal to 0, they are 1. And so in fact, that's how we set the normalization with the condition that ln of 0 is equal to 1, right? So this is a sequence where it's kind of different from the other two sets we have discussed, because they don't have this definite parity, right? So it's only the first function, which is kind of a trivial one, which is just a constant, but every other member of the sequence, it's neither odd nor even, right? As you can check. Okay, so let's move on. The first sort of important property of Laguerre polynomials is the orthonormality. After all, these are orthogonal polynomials. So let's write down this orthogonality property. And so the orthogonality property by construction is that you take the weight function and multiply any two polynomials and integrate inside the limits specific to the set of polynomials. In this case, it's from 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x ln of x times ln of x. This integral must be 0 whenever m is not equal to n. And the normalization integral, it turns out to be very straightforward to write down, and we will show how this comes about. So if you integrate from 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x ln squared of x is going to be 1. It's just as simple as that. Now let's show this. So to do this, we will start with the Rodrigues formula and use integration by parts repeatedly in a manner very similar to how we did with the earlier two examples. So we say 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x ln of x squared is the same as ln of x times ln of x. And one of these ln of x, we just leave it as it is. But the other ln of x, we replace it by the Rodrigues formula. So we have e to the x divided by n factorial, the nth times the nth derivative of e to the minus x times x to the n. And so then we observe that this is, this e to the minus x will cancel with this e to the x. And so we are just left with this integral 0 to infinity dx ln of x. You know, this 1 by n factorial also we can pull out. And so basically we have some u dv, right? So there is a function times a derivative. So whenever you have this, immediately it suggests that we should try integration by parts. And indeed that works out very well here. So we write down u integral u dv is the same as uv evaluated at the two ends. So ln of x times the n minus 1th derivative of this stuff, e to the minus x times e, x to the n, 0 to infinity minus integral 0 to infinity dx. Then you have to take a derivative du and then v, 1 over, so here it's just 1 over n factorial, the n minus 1th derivative of this function. Right, so now we argue that this quantity, the boundary term is actually going to go to 0 at both ends separately, at plus infinity and at minus, at 0. At 0 it goes to 0 because you have x to the n, right? So I mean, I'm assuming that n is at least 1, right? So if you you can check explicitly finally that this result also holds with n equals 0, right? I mean, but let's say that n is greater than or equal to 1 at this point. So when n is greater than or equal to 1, indeed the value of this integral at plus infinity, of course, e to the minus x will kill it, and at x equal to 0, you have this other term which is going to kill it, right? So I mean, let's say that you have a sufficiently high power of x. I mean, maybe even for x equal to, for n equal to 1 also, you can explicitly check it. N equal to 0, n equal to 1, n equal to 2, the first few terms you can explicitly check this quantity. But in any case, for higher powers, we'll argue that, you know, you have a e to the minus x times x to the n, and so you're taking only the n minus 1th derivative of this. So every term is going to have at least 1x sitting there, right? So if it is so it also will hold for n equal to 1. So if you have x times e to the minus x and then you take a derivative, you don't take a derivative, so it's just e to the minus x times x. So n minus 1 is just 0, so there's no derivative involved. So indeed x equal to 0 is going to go to 0, e to the minus x also is going to go to 0 at plus infinity. So this is going to be 0 at both ends. So then you're left with just this minus 0 to infinity dx, the derivative of this function, times 1 over n factorial, n minus 1th derivative of this stuff. And then we crank the wheel again. I mean, it's the same method applied again and again until we reach a point where there is no more derivatives, there is no more d by dx left, right? So that happens in a moment. But I mean, the key point is that every time this boundary term is going to keep on going to go to zero at both ends because of the presence of e to the minus x and x. You know, at both limits there are factors which will ensure that it is just zero. So the boundary terms don't live, and then you will keep oscillating between minus 1 and plus 1. So you will have a factor of minus 1 to the n when you keep doing this n times. So there is going to be come a point, so the next time you're going to get the d squared of ln of x, then d cube, and so on. And when you do this n times, you're going to get the nth derivative of ln of x, which you can pull out. It does not have to lie inside the integral. The reason is ln of x is a polynomial of degree n, so the nth derivative of and degree n polynomial is a constant, so the constant will come out, and there are no more derivatives left here, so this function will remain as it is. So all we have to do is work out this nth derivative and work out this integral, and then we are done, right? So in order to do this, let's start with this nth derivative of ln of x. Yeah, so this we'll go back to the Rodrigues formula. So the nth derivative of this is the same as the nth derivative of this whole stuff, which is in turn, which can be written as 1 over n factorial nth derivative of minus 1 to the n times x to the n, so on, right? So the idea here is that if you're going to take the nth derivative with respect to x, there is going to be a bunch of terms here, and I'm talking about this nth derivative. So you're going to take an nth derivative of a polynomial. Now the only term which will remain is the highest order term. Everybody else is going to just go to zero. And what is the highest order term? That's going to come when, you know, in each step you take a derivative only with respect to e to the minus x. You have to leave this entire x to the n as itself, because if you take a derivative with respect to x to the n even once, then the order of that term is going to be lower than n, and then when you take this nth derivative outside, it's going to not contribute. So the only term we are interested in is the first one, the highest order term, which corresponds to just minus 1 to the n times e to the minus x. But this e to the minus x will go away with e to the x, and you're just left with x to the n. And then we have pulled out this factor 1 over n factorial outside, and so it's very straightforward to see that the answer now is going to be just, you know, taking a derivative of x to the n, n times, and that's going to give you n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 all the way down to 1, so that's n factorial. So this n factorial will cancel with this n factorial in the denominator, and you are left with just minus 1 to the n, right? So straightforward to see that the nth derivative of ln of x is just minus 1 to the power n. Now, this is also something that we saw explicitly in the first few terms that we wrote down. So the nth derivative is just basically, it's like the constant term. So you have a 1 here, then you have another 1 here, a 1 here, and so on. So you have to be careful, but basically let's see. So if you take the nth derivative of the first derivative, and so if I it's the first term, so in this case it's just 1, then you have a minus 1, then you have 2 times x, it's going to be a plus 1, so you get a minus 3x squared times 2x, so it's going to give you a minus. So you see indeed that it's going to be exactly like what we have seen here, minus 1 to the n. Okay, so let's work out the other integral, which is a familiar integral, 0 to infinity dx times e to the minus x, x to the n, which is, again we'll do this by parts. So this is u dv, so it's, you write the first term as, u here is e to the x to the n, and dv is e to the minus x, so you write it as minus e to the minus x times x to the n, 0 to infinity, plus, so then we have to take a derivative of this function x to the n, so you get an n x to the n minus 1, and there is this minus which combines with the minus from this integral, and so you get a plus n times 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x, x to the n minus 1, and then we keep repeating it, and first of all argue that this boundary term is 0 because it's 0 at plus infinity and it's 0 at 0 separately because of these factors x and e to the minus x, so all these boundary terms will go to 0, and then you keep repeating this in a recursive way, and then you get n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 all the way down to 1, and you're just left with this integral 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x, which you can evaluate, and it's going to be just 1, right? So this is just n factorial. So basically we have managed to show that this integral, the normalization integral, is minus 1 to the n divided by n factorial, so that's this guy, and then we have a minus 1 to the n which comes from here, and then we have an n factorial which comes from here, and so if you take the product of all these, it's just 1, right? So ultimately the normalization integral is just 1 for every index involved, And so the compact way to write down the orthonormality condition is to just say integral 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x ln of x times ln of x is equal to Kronecker delta mn. Okay, so that's all for this lecture. Thank you.